Namaste, Hare Krishna. Welcome all of you to another session on the introduction of holistic understanding of cow care. You should be wondering, what is this holistic understanding of cow care different from the conventional thing that you are facing? So to understand more on holistic, we will look into, we'll introduce you to what holistic means. In that, I am Dr. Sri Kumar. My wife, Dr. Srigala, both of us are veterinarians who graduated from Kerala Veterinary College. And then we joined the dairy cooperative in Kerala, where it is called TRCMP Limited or Milma, as you have Amul or Nandini in different states. There we worked for 20 years, from 1992 to 2010. In 2010, we resigned from that organization because of certain disturbances we felt with respect to the cow care. We had no difference between with the organization, but with respect to the care and protection given to the cows, we were a bit disturbed. In which way we were disturbed is that when we were asked to attain certain targets of in milk production, in milk procurement every year, because the procured milk is what we have to sell in dairy cooperatives. To attain that particular targets, we found that the number of animals that we had in Kerala was not sufficient. It was some mismatch was there. So we were forced to bring cows from outside the state. That is, from Tamil Nadu, we had to bring cows to Kerala to meet the increased demand for milk in the state. So when we were analyzing why we had to bring cows from outside, because every year cows were delivering in India, in Kerala also, then why we had to bring cows from outside? So in search of that, we found that of the 100 calves that were female calves that were born in Kerala, only 14 survived. All others were dying, or they were having stunted growth, or may at times come to delivery by about 6th or 7th year. So this mismatch was there. That was the reason why the milk yield in the state was going down with respect to the number of animals we had. So when this was brought into our minds, again, that the calves are not taken care of, then we thought, how can the system go on like this? The farmers are leaving the dairy field, they are not continuing with the dairy, they are saying it is not viable, it is not feasible. So there is something wrong. So that we thought, when the farmers who are the backbone of the dairy cooperative, when they themselves say that we are not sustained, we are not able to sustain ourselves with these cows, then what's the point in working in such an organization and trying to get money from it? So that disturbance, that mismatch really hurt us, and we decided we'll come out of it, do something on our own, find out solution to it. That prompted us to come out of it. And then what we decided was, we went in search of some land, where we decided we will start a heifer project. That heifer project we thought we would start. And with the heifer project means, those animals which were born but have not delivered, those calves are taken care of specially by us in our own land, and then by impregnating them, we were planning to give to the farms, so that at least to increase the 14% to a higher level. So with that respect, with that thought, project in our mind, we purchased some land, and then when we were actually into the real strategy, one question from one of my gurus that really what made us to think a lot, that, you know, even if you take care of a calf, grow them properly into a cow and impregnate her and sell it to a farmer, what is the guarantee you have that he will take care of the calf that is born to her? So that question, really, we didn't have an answer to it. So then we thought, going ahead with an heifer project also, we will also end up in such a problem. So there is something else that was happening. So then we thought, we will stall the heifer project for some time and do little more research. Then we, out of providence, we came to Belgaum. And here we came in contact with the ISKCON Belgaum, their Gokuldam project. At that time, when we reached here, Gokuldam project was facing a community crisis of ticks on their animals. Gokuldam project is about 40 kilometers from Belgaum city. It is 450 acres of land wherein they are trying to build up a community. They don't use electricity. and they wanted to bring back, I mean, go away from the new technologies and to do a proper community with respect and with more concern towards the Vedic concepts. So when we reached there, we found that the cows were all, lot of ticks were on their body and the cows were suffering, and the caretakers and the devotees who were taking care of the cows, they were also a bit concerned about what was happening with the cows. So at that time, Bhaktirasamana Swami Maharaj, who is in chairing the project, he, Maharaj, requested us to be a part of the project so that to find out a solution. So when we started searching for the solutions of the tick problem, actually our answer to the initial problem of the calf being not taken care of in Kerala, everything, and this tick problem in Govardhan project, farmers are leaving dairy, everything actually, even though they look as different problems, they actually arouse from one issue. So in more and more research on that tick issue, we found out that if you keep the animals in confinement and in a particular place for a long time, there is more chance for the ticks to develop on the cow. And then another thing is that, you know, another person who was a dairy farmer here, his name is Sujit. When we met him and went to his farm, we found out that he similarly had the problem of the ticks, and he kept some poultry there. And he shared his experience that when he kept the poultry there, the tick load was controlled. So then when you fix up now all these issues, the experience of different persons in different areas, we found out that the problem is that we confine them on to the goshalas. That is the reason why the tick issue came. So then again we went further to be on our search in North India. Also we had opportunity to meet many people like Deepti Agarwal. When we met her and worked for her in her farm, more and more answers to our problems could be identified. So then one day we going through the Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam, the first canto, the 17th chapter, the third verse, where it's third sloka, where it says, although the cow is beneficial because one can draw religious principles from her, she was now rendered poor and calfless. Her legs were being beaten by a Shudra. There were tears in her eyes and she was distressed and weak. She was hankering after some grass in the field. You just look at the two things which I highlighted. That is, poor and calfless and hankering after some grass in the field. So this particular sloka gave us the reason why the dairy farmers or the people who are keeping cows or the cows themselves are facing all the problems now. That is, all the problems with respect to dairy is because the calf is separated from the mother. That is, the cow is suffering out of grief that the calf is separated. And the other one is, she is hankering for a blade of grass. That means she is kept away from the grazing land. These two things, we could understand that is the main reason for all the problems that everybody is facing with respect to keeping cows. So then, if you look into these two aspects, even now, in this particular moment, if you look, these two things are not addressed. The calves are separated from the mother. If you look into, go to any dairy farm, you see that the calves are separated from the mother. And they are kept in the stall fed. They are not sent for grazing. They are away from the grazing land. So the problem still exists, even at this moment. So only when these two abuses that you are doing to these animals, that is, we can expect the cows to be happy, and any project that you want to plan with cows to be sustainable, these two things have to be addressed. That is, the cow and the calf should be together, and the cow and the grazing land should be together. This separation is the reason for the crisis that is now happening in the dairy industry. So when I had an opportunity to see some of the Vedic codes, like you see this particular Vedic code, Veda and other Veda, it says Milk derived forcibly from cows is poisonous and leads to innumerable incurable diseases. That is, by separating the calf from the mother and trying to draw the milk forcibly from her will lead to innumerable incurable diseases in the person who is consuming it. So the two things which I told you, remember from the sloga, that is the calf is separated from the mother. So what is the consequence of separating the calf from the mother? One, milk derived forcibly leads to innumerable incurable diseases. So now we look at the other aspect, that is keeping the cow away from the pastures. Pastures should have free access to the animals. What does that say? Barriers in pastures, that is in keeping away the cow from the pastures, angers the cows. The milk from such cows is likened to poison. So that means this milk that is coming from a cow that has been stall fed, or the same milk that is coming from a cow that is separated from the cow, both are poisons. That means if a consumer who drinks the milk of such a cow is drinking poison, and it leads to innumerable incurable diseases. What is this innumerable incurable disease? It is just, what is that milk? That milk is nothing but the A1 milk that you are consuming today. That means a problem that is created in the cow is creating a problem in the persons who are consuming the milk of the cow. So if you get it, actually trace it, we can understand that the real problems that is faced by the consumer or the producer who is keeping the cow is because of two problems. That one is the cow and the calf are separated, and the other one is and the cow and the grazing land are separated. So in Vishnu Purana there is a saying that in Kali Yuga cows will be honored as long as she delivers milk. That means as long as she gives milk, she will be honored. Once, see, even if you see any go puja, you are supposed to keep a cow and a calf. No other cow is taken for the puja. So once your cow is not producing, then you don't want that cow. What happens to that cow once she is not giving milk? She goes to starved and kept in some gosharas. Now it has become a practice that, you know, those cows that are thrown away from the gosharas are taken by religious institutions. They take it and keep it in their gosharas. But still, even though they take it, see, this is another picture where you see the cows were taken for slaughter, and there are people who are very much who are sentimental to the cows. They are after the such vehicles, catch out of those vehicles and bring them to some goshalas, where again it is a burden. They have to be fed. That means the problem still is there. That means there is something missing, even though you have saved the cow from the slaughterhouse. See the picture. These are all goshalas wherein the cows have been saved to religious institution goshalas. Still they are starved. See another goshala. Wherever such goshalas have come up, the plight of the cows is the same. Because we don't see any utility in them. See another goshala. This goshala now has about 42,000 cows. And they have only 30 acres. How can they manage 42,000 cows in 30 acres? It's not possible. See another question. Wherever you see, whichever goshala you go, this is the picture. Overcrowding. And when you overcrowd and when you give the food, the heftier ones or the stronger ones get the food and the others start to dwindle. They start to die. So they are not taken to a better place by saving them from slaughterhouse. That means again the problem is still lying. Underlying problem is still not addressed. So why is this happening? It is because the need of a change from the reductionist to the holistic management is the root of the problem. Why such things are happening is because of the reductionist thinking. That is, you see only one thing useful in a cow, that is milk. Or in a bull, you see if it is good for work, only it is useful. When you are not seeing the cow as a whole, either you want the dung, some people keep the cows for dung or urine to make cow products, still you don't want the cow. You are happy if somewhere cow, the dung and urine comes to you to your goshala, you are happy. Keeping care, taking care of the cow has become a liability. By just such culling of cattle is just because the management of cattle is on a reductionist principle. Because you see only certain things as the utility. You don't see the cow as a whole. You see only the milk the dung or the urine. You, if some by some other source, like you know, now people are giving away their cows and started to purchase the milk because it is a liability keeping a cow. That is because of the reductionist thinking. Then, what is this holistic mean? Holistic management, the thing is, you know, we take four things into consideration. That is, you have to take care of the social aspect. A decision, it's a decision-making process. That is wherein you will look into the four aspects when you make a decision. Anything, any aspect you decide in your life, when if you are taking a holistic decision, four aspects should be considered. That is, the social aspect, the economic aspect, the environmental aspect, and the spiritual aspect. If these four things are addressed, then you will never have an unexpected, unwanted consequence. If you don't look into this, any aspect, see, even if you want to kill a cockroach with a chemical, how it will affect you socially, how will it affect you, and how will it affect the environment. If you think any decision, anything, any decision that you take, it is a problem of the human being that we always look into the reductionist side. Anything you take, we always follow the reductionist principle. We don't look at the holistic aspect of it. Like, you know, you in case of a human being having a problem with his teeth. So he straight away goes to, oh, my problem is with my teeth. So whom should I meet? I should go and meet a dentist. So then he will say it is because of a bacteria on the teeth. But a problem of the teeth can never come because of a bacteria on the teeth. It is because of the body as a whole. The dentist does not look at the body as a whole. He only thinks about the teeth. And he starts to apply something on the teeth. Oh, this teeth is gone, you have to remove it. He is not addressing the whole aspect. That is, this teeth is in his mouth. And this his mouth is a part of the head. And this head is a part of the full whole body. So in the holistic approach, you look at the whole body. And the teeth is a part of it. But in reductionist, you see only the teeth. And how to manage the teeth. You cannot manage teeth separately. You cannot manage my hand separately. It's a part of my body. Anything happening to my hand means it has got some relation to my body. So that is the difference between the reductionist thinking and holistic thinking. You have to take as a whole. That you are looking only at the milk with respect to cows. Only milk. That means from where the cow milk is coming. How does the milk come? What does the cow have to eat? In which environment it has to live? Those things are not taken care of. In many cases we have seen, in many visits we have done to many farmers' houses, we have noticed that the feeding is poor, but still they complain there is no milk. How can that happen? They do not know, or they are not made to think that milk comes only when the cow eats something. That relation is missing. So you will only think, why milk is not coming? I want milk, I have to sell milk, then only I can make money. But they are not thinking you have to spend money on food. What is their food? Those things are not addressed. So that is the difference between the reductionist and the holistic thinking. So then another aspect which I would like to stress is on the function and the utility of the cow. If you look into, please understand two things, function and utility. What is the dictionary meaning of function? What is the dictionary meaning of utility? The dictionary meaning of function is the purpose of something or someone or an activity that is natural. That is something that particular thing is destined to do. Whereas, what is utility? The state of being useful, profitable or beneficial. That is, you are looking into something, how it will be beneficial to me. The other one is, for what purpose that has been brought into this world. That's the two different. So now, with respect to cows, what is the real function of the cow? And what is the utility of the cow? You see both the things. What is the real function of the cow? Is what it will do when it is allowed to perform on the land. When you leave it in the environment, what will it do? That is its function. For example, I will give you another way. Like, you know, if you think about a bird, like poultry, you have poultry at home. What does it do when it is let out? It will go, scratch the floor, peck something here, peck something there. So what is it doing by scratching the floor? It is aerating the soil. It is helping the ecosystem. Like, you know, it is aerating the soil. It is by pecking, it is removing the pest there from the soil. And you have to notice why the bird is given a beak. It does not have a teeth. That means the creator has had a purpose in it. What is the function in giving that beak? Because it will peck all the pest and the grains. So if you give some grains to the cow, and the next day if you look at the dung, you will see the grains in the dung. That means the cow does not have the capacity, even though it ruminates, it cannot ruminate and grind the grains, it is coming back. But you don't see the cow, you don't see any grass in the dung that is coming out. That means it is able to digest the grass, but it is not able to digest the grains. Why is it so? But a bird which pecks the grain, you don't see a grain in the stool. That means it has got something in its digestive tract called gizzard, which grinds the grains. Even though it grinds the grains, you should understand it does not have the capacity to grind the seeds of peru or many fruits. So how come, even though it grinded the grains like rice or wheat, how come it couldn't grind the seeds of fruits? So you should understand then why, then what happens to those grains? It is passed in the stool. The bird flies to some tree, it puts the feces, and from there it grows another tree. That means that particular each and every entity that is there in this world as a function. I'm not talking about human beings. Other than human beings, anything that has been created in this world, be it a cow, be it a dog, be it a poultry, whatever it is, it has a function. So now if we go closer into that bird, what is its function? It helps in aerating the soil, it helps in controlling the pest, it helps in propagation of seeds. It didn't help in propagation of grains. It helped in the propagation of seeds of the fruits. If you look at the Peru fruit which has been attacked or eaten by a bird, you will see it has dug a hole straight into the place where the seed is there. That means it is taking the seeds and performing its function, taking the seed and passing it through its stool to another place. So that is the function. So once you see only the utility of meat in that particular bird, then who will take care of the propagation of seeds? You will miss one function. So likewise, cow also has a function. And the function of the cow is its ability, inborn ability of grazing. Its relationship with the land. The grass has to associate with a herbivore, with a grazer. And cow is one among the grazers. And if that relationship is detached, you will have to face some ecosystem unwanted consequences. The same way, the primary function of a cow is its inborn quality of grazing. But the primary utility that is fixed on the cow is for milk and the bull is for traction. So if you fix, when you fix it on an utility, once that utility is not met, you are culling, you are disposing it. But as far as the, when you look at the function, lifelong, from the day it is born till it is gone, that is day it dies on its natural death, it is performing its function of grazing. It is useful. And in our remaining topics, I will go deep into what happens when it performs its function of grazing. And so then what is the function of the udder in the cow? The function of the udder in the cow is to feed its calf. So that is something which you have to see, that it is feeding the calf. So every part, everything as a whole, as a function. And so then I will ask you, what is the function of the human being? So it is very clear now, the function of the human being is that he should be intelligent enough to understand the function of everything around in the ecosystem. Cows, birds, plants, everything, he should be intelligent enough. He has been given the intelligence to understand the function of everything that is around him. And then he has to see, maintain the functions. He has to see that the functions are in place. That is what a farmer should do, should understand and basically do. I hope you have understood the difference between the function and utility. You take anything, the difference is you, the nature has decided a function. That means the person who created it has decided a utility, that is its function. And when we start using it, we fix a utility on it. And in any case, utility should come only after the function. Land and cow care, or utility should come only after the function, or both should be the same. The function and the utility should be the same. In case your function is the function of that thing is different and the utility you have fixed is different, the particular element or particular entity will go. It will have to die. A sad death. But in land and cow care also, we have to know each and everything that is you see growing on your land as an utility, as a function. And the utility that you have fixed should match with the function of it. Now we will, for the practical, to understand the practically, we look into a farming enterprise. You look to the left side. The left side, you see the things that are the pumps, the starters, the computer, the mobile, the tractors, the cars and bikes you may be having in a farm are the things that you have purchased. And these are the things that you have made, that the human beings have made. And these are the things wherein the function and the utility are the same. That is, you have purchased, we have made a car for what? For travel. So what will be using the car for? For travel. Or to take some of your things. What will be using the pumps? To pump water, whatever it is. So those things that are on the left are the things that are made by human beings and wherein the function and the utility are the same. And anything that goes wrong, that means in the pump, if something goes wrong with one of the parts of the pump cannot function. It will be dysfunctional. So then you need a person who knows to repair it. So that means it is a bit technology oriented, it is a bit complicated. You do not know. I do not know how a pump functions. So I need a technically qualified person to come and repair it because it is complicated. So I hope you understood what is the things in the left hand side. That is what we made, the technology side. Now why have you made all these things? Why are we using all these things? To manage the things that you see on the right hand side. What is it? All the things that are in the farm, the biological part in the farm. What are the things in the farm? You have the cropland, you have the crops, you have grasslands, air, water, sunlight, animals, their livestock and labor. So you are using all the things in the left, that are those things are complicated, to use them for managing the things on the right. That is, those things which are complex. Complex means even though one part goes, still it will function. For example, you have some cows. Today you didn't get grass. Still, by eating something else, it will survive. But in the case of the other part where it's complicated, if one particular nut is not there, that particular instrument may not function. But in the nature or the biological part, it is complex that even if one part is not functioning, that whole system will function. So all that you have purchased or managing is to manage the biology. But the difference is, all the things you see on the right are biological things and the function and the utility are not the same. You have to, if you look at the livestock, you take, for the example, you take the livestock. The function of the cow is grazing. But you are using it for milk. So then what will be the picture? Again, you will have the same. So, if you look at this chart, we are trying to manage the right side. For the utility, we fixed on it, but actually that is not their function. See, if you take the grasslands, what is their function? You see that in the croplands, are the most of the croplands you see it as monocropping, wherein the diversity is the rule of the land. So in many cases, why are we using the pumps? Why are we using the tractors? It is to manage the utility we fixed on them, but actually that is not their utility. It's not their function. So, you have to get a clear understanding on all the things that you see on the left, man made it. And man made each and everything for a particular function. And that is utilized for the same function. So, there is no problem. But the other one, which is designed by the Lord, which has its function, which is not understood by the farmer, but is using for is the utility he fixed on it. That is why you see many farmers or dairymen who ultimately come and say it is not profitable. But when you are doing when the utility and the function are the same, naturally then you are in tune with nature, you are destined to make profits. You can never lose because that is how it has been designed. When you use a computer for computing, how will you fail? Because that's a function. But you may not be able to use it as a table to write something. So that is how you have to decide. So then come see, with that you look at the cows. Which are, what is the, once you understand the utilities that we have, the dairy cows for milk and the draught animals, that is the animals that the bulls that are used for work are the draught. So the two utilities that we have with this, either milk or draught purpose. So if the, if its utility and the function were the same, then they would have never reached this place. They are now in the garbage. How did they reach the garbage? Because after that there is no use. So that means the Lord made some mistake. No, it cannot happen. The Creator has never made a mistake. So the same way, if you had, so then there is something else that its function is, or the utility has to reach the function level. But just imagine, as I told before, the function of the cow is its inability, is its inborn ability to graze. Then in that case, this cow also can graze. The only thing that I have not told you is how it, the benefit of grazing. That will come in my next class on the grazing aspect when it comes, you will understand. So then, now you have that, you know, holistic and the conventional. Conventional means the reductionist type of farming and the holistic type of farming. Be it daring or anything you do, any enterprise with respect to biology or the biological course of the nature, whatever try to manage the ecosystem, the difference between the holistic approach and the conventional approach, I just tell you, just look at it. That is, in a holistic approach, in with respect to dairying, we see the whole herd as productive. That is, all the animals in your group are productive because you don't fix the utility of milk or draught. But with respect to the conventional thing, we have unproductive. In that we say these animals are unproductive because we have fixed utility on either milk or draught. Any animal that is not performing these two functions are considered unproductive or useless, and you end up culling it. What is culling? Culling is you are removing a particular person or an animal or a plant which you think is not good or beneficial for you. So in this, in the holistic approach, you will not have culling, because all the animals are, their functions are their utility. So in that case, you will never have any animal in that herd as non-productive. But when you have certain things, when the utility and the function are not the same, and when the utility is not met, you will call them as unproductive. So in the conventional method, culling of the unproductive is practiced to sustain that enterprise. That means when one animal is not giving milk, you cull that animal so that you become profitable. But in case of the holistic approach, you will never cull for sustainability. You will give it as daan, because giving that animal to another person will only reduce your expense. But it will reduce your expense because you, that animal is productive, but still you are using it, you are not seeing it as an unproductive, but you are giving it to another person. That is, when you give it to another person, you are seeing that that will again live the same way and be productive to him. The other one, you have only one utility that has to go for slaughter. Then, the as far as the holistic is concerned, the goal that the person has set is health, his own health, his family's health, his community's and his nation's health. That is his goal. Whereas in conventional farming, goal is just profit or money. And how quick I can get it. That is how in conventional. But in the other one, how much can be taken without diminishing it? What can it produce decently for an infinite period of time? That is, you, when you take something from the holistic farm, you will, that is, you have farmed. And before farming, if you have seen the organic carbon in your land is 2. After farming, it should be 2.1, it should only increase. Whereas in the conventional farming, you don't look at the organic. You just put how quickly I can get, you are not bothered whether it has diminished or not. But in the case of holistic farming, you will only think, how can I take it without diminishing it? Because you always take care of your future resource. The other one, before I die, I only get what is possible. But here, not like me, my family, and the generations to come, that will be the person in the holistic mode will be thinking. And then, with respect to the dairying in the holistic, what he will look is, the animal performance, that is, whether it is a good drought breed, drought has a purpose, the drought, whether it is milking, how their health is, animal, then their grazing behavior, and how they manifest on the soil, how they perform on the soil, how their grazing benefits the soil. These three things they take into consideration with respect to dairy in the holistic aspect, that is, the animal performance, the grazing aspect, and how that animal performs by the function of grazing, how it benefits the land, soil, the soil. That is how he will do with respect to the holistic one. But the other one, animal performance is the only thing that they do. How, whether it's affecting the, whether they graze or not bother. You purchase something, feed, get the product, and we grow. How it affects the soil, not at all bother. So that is the difference between the conventional and the holistic. We were in, when we were working in the dairy cooperative, we were actually supporting the conventional. Now, what we resigned from it, and when I told we resigned, is we resigned from the conventional veterinary, and now we are with the holistic veterinary. That we now cannot think of an animal being unproductive. Even if you are not able to understand the function, we investigate, research, and find out the real function of that particular animal, and tell them to the farmers, and make them use those animals for that particular function should be the utility of that animal. Then, because in nature, nature functions as whole. As I told before, a cow, even though it gives milk, milk does not just come early morning from the udder. It has to eat something. 500 liters of milk has to pass through the udder to produce 1 liter of milk. How does the nutrients come to the blood? It is through the food that it has taken. How does it consume food? It has to graze somewhere, it has to eat something. And then how does it get digested? And then for that, it has to do the act of grazing. So all these together, put together, comes the cow. The same way, where is the cow grazing? It is grazing on the land. So you have to think of the land. So that means in nature, you cannot see cow alone. You cannot take a cow, put it in a room, and early morning go and milk. It will not happen. It functions as a whole. It has to relate with the land. Even if you are cutting and giving also, you have to relate to the land. And then the climate, the rainfall, everything is affected. So, in nature, everything functions as a whole. You cannot have your hand functioning alone. It needs the nervous supply from the brain, from the spinal cord. So the whole body has to help with the functioning of your hand. You have to walk to get something to eat. You need your hand to take it to your mouth. You need your teeth to bite it. Then only your hand starts functioning. Your hand cannot function alone. And your body functions as a whole. Your body is related to the soil. Your body is related to the whole universe. So that is how it is. You cannot see a man can function alone without anything. It cannot happen. So that is exactly what you mean. Whole is some. Whole. The other one is reductionist. Nothing. Only man. Only cow. Only milk. That is what we call reductionist. So then, I have another example. We cannot or we should not manage plants in isolation from the soil they grow in, or from the animals that graze them. That is, animals need, that is a herbivore, needs the presence of plants. And the plants need the activity of the grazers. That is how nature has designed them. When we study about that grazing aspect, we will understand when that act of grazing is learned, how it is helping the plant. I give it in a short way. That is, you have a rose plant, you prune it. And when you prune it, it again grows. And then again you rest that particular plant for certain period, and then you start getting the rose. The same way the cow or the animal, whichever is grazing, grazes the tips. It is like pruning. And then you have to rest that land, that particular plant, so that it regrows. So the same thing you do in a garden is being done there by the cows. That is the relation. They need to be eaten, then only they can spread. See, a grass, when it is like this, if it is constantly rested and grazed, it will start to expand its base. So it grows, it wants to grow. If it has to grow, then it has to be eaten. So that is the function of the animal with respect to the grass, and the function of the grass with respect to the animals. That is how, in the ecosystem, that is how it functions. See, you see in this, the cows have been separated from the grazing land and they are kept in the stall. For what? For the utility of milk. Or maybe for dung, to collect dung for making products, or for urine to make products. Whereas its natural habitat is the grazing land. So you see a fish, which is its habitat? water. You remove the fish from its habitat, what happens? It dies. This, and it is not possible to keep it hanging, I mean, alive in the air. So same way, the cow's habitat is the land, the grazing land. It has to be there. You cannot keep them in the goshala. And keeping them in the goshala, if you are planning to manage the cow by touching the dung and touching the grass, it is going to be a huge liability for you. It is very expensive to manage the dung. You just, if everybody who is having a goshala, just imagine the money you are spending on just cleaning the goshala. The money you are spending on cutting grass and bringing it here, how much money you are spending. But just imagine they are on the grazing land. The picture is different. Because they are self-feeders. They have to feed on their own. They know to self-feed. You need not feed them. Then, so the same way, the grass, we remove the cows from the grasslands to do factory farming. And with what happened? The grasslands are becoming deserts. Because there is no interaction between the cow and the grazers, the herbivores and the plants. So the grasslands are becoming deserts. Fruits and vegetables have gone low in nutrients because now there is no animal impact. The urine, dung falling on the grasslands. No, you have to put, it is on the mercy of the grower. If he puts some dung and urine only, that soil gets something. Otherwise, when the cows were herded, they were naturally getting it. So what happens now? There is no productivity. Say cows are non-productive and they are being cut. You see this, which I told about that breeding, holistic. We here, you have the bulls. They are bred just for meat. See the size of the animal? Is this a good look for a bull? It has been bred exclusively for meat, and this is how it has happened. And see the cow, which has been bred exclusively for meat. Look, it can't even bear the weight of the udder. This is breeding against the whole. You are not, you are only breeding for meat. You are not seeing what is the growing season of the grass. You are not seeing the improvement in soil carbon, improvement in soil organic matter. As the cows graze, every year the soil organic matter has to improve. Based on that, the breed has to improve. Now you are not at all looking at the soil. You are only looking at the cow and breeding for the udder. So what you see, the net effect is the healthy lifespan of the cows got reduced. That means for the third pregnancy, they are losing their health. You need calcium supplementation to keep them sustained. Udder cannot produce more milk because of mastitis. Because more milk means it is difficult to drain it out. So not improper draining means it ends up in mastitis. They get infected with incurable diseases like TB, brucellosis and jaundice disease because of the intensive feeding things, and they are kept in, they are lying in the dung and urine. So always in polluted atmosphere, giving rise to diseases like TB and jaundice disease. Then dairying became unprofitable for the producer because of diseases, and then you have to purchase everything to feed them, and then as a result, what happened? A cow which is not producing to your expected is sent for slaughter. What happened is meat trade flourished. So in the convention, the present thing, what is happening is the lifespan is reduced, more diseases like mastitis, and chronic diseases like brucellosis, jaundice disease, TB. It is understood that more than 40% of the cows in India are having TB or brucella or jaundice disease. And no one is saying it is profitable without slaughter. I should say without slaughter, no one is saying it is profitable. And meat trade is flourishing. But in a healthy herd, that is when you have the three things in mind, that is the performance, the grazing and the soil health, then that will increase their lifespan, profitable dairying, you will have a disease-free herd, and cow care will manifest. The other one, it is only, you are only looking at the production or the utility of the animal. See, one thing that you have to understand is, each and every person, you may be earning lakhs, crores, whatever you are. This basic thing you have to understand. Without agriculture, it is not possible to have a city, stock market, banks, university, places of worship or army. Agriculture is the foundation of civilization and stable economy. Without that, there is nothing. You cannot even think of what the fortune you are thinking you are getting. What will you do with the money you are going to earn with? There is no farm. What will you do? What will you purchase with that money that you are going to make if there is no proper agriculture? cow, and cow is an integral part of agriculture. Because that is what nourishes the soil. You need the animals for nourishment. Previously, before these inorganic fertilizers or synthetic fertilizers came, it was the animals that nourished the soil. And one thing that they advertised during the introduction of the synthetic fertilizers was, you don't need animals now. So animals went off the habitat into the sheds. And they started using a cheap method of just pouring some urea or whatever it is. By the inbuilt function of grazing and animal impact, these animals help us in farming, cows. And in this, the whole, grass too is a crop. Because as long as you have herbivores in your house, be it goat, sheep, cow, or whatever animal is, herbivore means, that means you need grass. So that too is a crop in actual organic farming. And having a grass and the effect of grazing will all, I'll be dealing with in the grazing aspect, when we deal with the grazing aspect. And for economic viability in a dairy enterprise, if you look at the project reports that is being put before, if you want to get money from the bank, if you look at the project report, one part says the culling of animals. That is, how much do you get by sale of unproductive animals? How much money you will get by the sale of unproductive calves, male calves? That too is taken into account to bring in an economic viability of a project report. So what does that mean? That means dairy and slaughter and slaughter are complementary. You need slaughter for the sustainability of dairy. You cannot separate it. If you just imagine, this is my, you just take it as interest, it shows some interest to you. Just look around you. That if you are purchasing milk, you cannot get a drop of milk in the market if there is no slaughter. Because for sustainability, the poor farmer has to cull the cow. Cull the cow means, if he has to get the money, he cannot just simply send it out. He has to, who is giving the money? Only the slaughter people can give money. It's not that. So why I'll tell you, it's easy to understand. See, you have a cow. Naturally, if it is dairying, there will be a calf with it. So a cow and a calf. And then for breeding, you need a goat. So in a natural way, if you want to do it, not the conventional way, in a holistic way, if you want to do it, or where you want them to be kept the natural way, you need a cow for your milk, there will be a calf, and there will be a bull to breed. So there is three. So what is the percentage of animals that's productive? It is 30%. So next year, again, you have one more calf, then only you have milk. Now it is 25%. That is, only one is productive, other three are non-productive if milk is the utility. So at any point of time, either 25 to 30% only will be productive in a holistic herd if you think milk is the utility. So to make it profitable, you have to cull the 75. Then only it is viable. Where does culling go? It goes to slaughterhouse. So this you should basically understand, that these two are complementary. I always think, many people, they say, see, we have to prevent the culling, the animals are thrown out, we have to prevent it. Okay, then what are you going to do? I'm going to give some donation to some goshaya. Okay, you donate to the goshaya. Then, where do you get the milk from? I purchase it from here. So, what are you doing? On one side you are promoting slaughter, and the other side you are promoting a goshala where the slaughter animals are coming. Who is doing both? Doing the same thing. How can you do the both the same thing at a time? When you are purchasing milk, you are promoting slaughter. Because he has to slaughter. Otherwise he cannot sell it to you at that price. The other one, those slaughter animals have gone to another place, there you are donating. It doesn't make sense to me. You please think, you both are the same. These cows, we are sent for slaughter or culling only because without slaughter you cannot get milk in the market. Not even a drop of milk will come to the market because if there is no slaughter. Then See this. You see, if you are saying, I don't want to send them to slaughter, I'll then send them out, let them go anywhere. Now what is happening here? You have a band. So in those days, the workers, the Protestants who are protesting, they will come and stand in the road, protesting the vehicles, not allowing the vehicles. So see what is happening, those culled cows, they are all standing in the road. No vehicle can move. Which are these cows? Those who are sent out from your land only. So if you don't allow slaughter, they will be on the road. But they are actually fighting for getting their land for to perform their functions. If you think in that, just look at them and listen. If you had given them the land, they would have performed their functions. One more warning I tell you, the more you remove the cows from land, the more deeper the water level will go. Those things I will be explaining properly in the, I will try to explain properly in the coming sessions. So just imagine, so these cows are in the field, in the road, protesting before you to allow them or give them their habitat so that they can perform their functions. They will be seeing, tears have the same meaning in every language. They are crying because, not because they are going to be slaughtered. No, I don't mean to say that they are crying because they are going to be slaughtered. No, they are crying because they have not performed their functions. You have not permitted them to perform their functions. So, pillars of for sustainability in cow care are three things that are mentioned. One is the animal performance, the grazing aspect, and the soil, regenerative farming. That is, by the animal performing on the performing their function of grazing, they help in the soil for regenerative farming. Now, it is degenerative because you only look at the animal performance. This is something which the first president of US told, that the nation that destroys its soil, destroys itself. So how that soil can be regenerative, how the soil can be productive is dependent on how your herbivores graze on the land. Without them, you look at the forest. In the forest also, you see the abundance in forest, the things growing in the forest, actually it is with the help of the animals that are living in the forest. They are a part of, integral part of that forest. The same way when you farm, you need animals to be on the land. Otherwise, you will never ever get real food. All the food that you can be deficient in minerals, which I will discuss in the next topic of ecosystem literacy. And I hope you have understood from this session that the difference between, that in the internet section, what I have tried to put forward before you is, as a summary, and again, putting before you that there is something difference between the function and utility of cows. Unless and until the function and the utility are the same, it is not going to be sustainable. And that the pillars, three pillars of sustainability, like the grazing, the animal performance, the grazing and the soil. Please bear in mind before starting a dairy that only if your intention of farming is to allow the animal to perform its functions, then only you can make it sustainable. So now I have told you about the conventional and the holistic. In the case of the holistic aspect, a holistic veterinary will always aim at managing the animals to perform its functions so that it is good for the land and all self-forms. Whichever animal it is, whether it is cow, whether it is goat, whether it is poultry, he will manage. He will only tell the farmers how you enable the animals to perform its function so that it is good for the land and all life forms. The function of the cow is that it feeds the soil by its quality of grazing, which is an integral process in an ecosystem. That is what the holistic veterinarian will aim at. The holistic veterinarian will see that the animals are well cared for until ending their lives as humanely as possible, just as you and I would wish to be treated. Not that, you know, you are only good for meat. They will look into the full functions and make the enterprise sustainable. You will not just look at the product of the utility alone. And the holistic veterinarian, he thinks cows are our resources. And common sense tells that resources do not cause the problems. It is how we manage them that results in the problems. A resource is never a problem. We should know how to manage the resources. And then for an holistic veterinarian, he is not afraid of the microorganism. For him, microorganisms are present at the site of the disease, but they are not the cause of the disease. For him, the real person the real thing that is the cause of the disease is, the main causative factor for all diseases of cows is not the microorganism, as far as the holistic veterinarian is concerned. It is the macroorganism, the person taking care of the man. That is the difference between how a holistic veterinarian views the ecosystem and the conventional veterinarian views the ecosystem. So I hope the things have been put before you, that we are able to introduce to the holistic aspect in the coming sessions of the ecosystem literacy, the grazing aspect, the feeding aspect. We will come into how cow is related to the soil and what happens to the soil if the cows are removed from it. Thank you.